grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I'm Reverend Barbara Clark in ministry with the folks at the Ilderton United Church in Ontario. A warm welcome to each and every one of you as we gather in friendship and in faith, as we gather to remind ourselves of what's truly important in these difficult days, as we gather to be present to the love of God in our hearts and to be grateful for the love of God in our lives, as we gather to rededicate ourselves to following the way of Jesus. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. In the name of love, there is strength for today. There is bright hope for tomorrow. Well, there are some beautiful fields of sunflowers around where we live in southwestern Ontario. And I have a beautiful bouquet of sunflowers here that I picked up at the Ilderton Market this morning. Maybe because the sunflower is a cheerful yellow, the flowers in the fields tall and strong and their faces turned towards the sun. Maybe that's why these words came to me this week. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Kind of like a prayer. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Perhaps these words will encourage you as they've encouraged me this week. And you probably recognize that these are also words from one of our old-time favorite hymns, Great is Thy Faithfulness, which we are going to sing.
Wondrous the portion of
Please pray with me now. O Holy One, when in the midst of uncertainty, may we know faith. When in the midst of anxiety, may we know serenity. When in the midst of stress, may we know calm. When in the midst of fear, may we know trust. When in the midst of bewilderment, may we know assurance. When in the midst of confusion, may we know confidence. When in the midst of pandemic, may we know peace. When in the midst of whatever it may be, may we know love. Amen. Our scripture passage is from the Gospel of Matthew. It's Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 to 33. This is where we hear of how Jesus walks on the water, and our reader today is the Reverend David Mitchell.
Immediately, he made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning he came walking toward them on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost," and they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, saying, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he said, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God."
Thank you, Reverend Dave. Thank you for reading. The disciples cried out in fear, but immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Fear, being afraid, this is a vital response to physical and emotional danger. This has been crucial throughout evolution. If people didn't feel fear, they wouldn't be able to protect themselves from legitimate threats. Being afraid and your subsequent response can save your life. That's why I think the disciples have every right to be afraid. Of course they're afraid. They're afraid because the storm has battered their boat. The water is seeping in and they don't want to drown. And then they're afraid when they see Jesus walking across the water because they can't process what they're seeing. Human beings don't have the ability to walk on water. Of course, we experience fear too. And this is a good metaphor for these days because there are lots of ways we may feel like we're drowning right now. Lots of ways we might feel as if we're in over our heads. I know some of you are making difficult decisions about whether your children will return to school. I know teachers who are legitimately afraid about returning. Some of us are afraid of the prospect of an indefinite number of months being socially isolated. And some of us feel fear because our basic biology betrays us into a clinical state of anxiety or panic attacks or depression. And Jesus says, "Do not be afraid. Fear not." These are phrases that occur frequently in the Bible. On the internet, someone wrote that "do not be afraid," that phrase, occurs 365 times in the Bible. Well, this may or may not be true, in particular, depending on the translation of the Bible you may be using. But let's say it is true enough. Let's say that "do not be afraid" occurs 365 times in the Bible. That's once for every day of the year. But I've got to tell you that this year, I think I've already used up my 365 times. So if Jesus tells us not to be afraid, then what are we supposed to be? Well, one answer I disagree with is that you need to be more faithful. That's like blaming the victim. If you had more faith, then you wouldn't have been afraid. But being afraid is a real, legit, biological protection. You can be faithful and afraid at the same time. I just offer today an idea that I read in Journeying with Jesus, a Christian blog. I just offer today that I'm not sure the issue here is about fear at all, but rather where fear can take us. Notice the first place that Peter's fear takes him. He has every right to be afraid when the boat is buffeted by the waves in the darkness. The problem is that his fear leads him straight to suspicion and distrust. His fear leads him to test and question Jesus' identity. "If it is you, Jesus, then prove it to me. If it is you, then let me do something humanly impossible like walk on water." Fear, the healthy and normal reaction, can take us into some unhealthy places. Like Peter, it can take us to suspicion and distrust. But also it can lead to resentment, aggression, hostility. And fear can be manipulated by others. And I see this all over the world right now. Fear can be manipulated by others to create division, violence, hatred, and war. But Jesus says, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." I think it's easy to miss the path that Jesus is suggesting for us. And I admit that I often do miss it because I just so much want to be rid of the adrenaline pumping fear that I feel sometimes. But the path Jesus offers us is to take heart. That's the pathway. Take heart. Don't let fear cause you to miss the fact that Jesus is coming to you across the water when you feel like you're in over your head. Take heart. Literally, have courage. Courage. Fill your heart not with fear's agenda, but rather embrace the things that God loves. Hope, peace, forgiveness, faith, compassion, hospitality. And once you're on that path, well, I just finished reading the late Marcus Borg's last book called Convictions: How I Learned What Matters Most. I recommend this book. What matters most, Marcus Borg writes in the last chapter. What's the Christian life all about? It's about loving God and loving what God loves. It's about becoming passionate about God and participating in God's passion for a different kind of world here and now. And the future, including what is beyond our lives, we leave that up to God. Wise words. May it ever be so. Amen. Our next hymn is Don't Be Afraid from More Voices, number 90. Don't be afraid, my love is stronger, my love is stronger than your fear. Don't be afraid, my love is stronger, and I have promised to be all near. Don't be afraid, my love is stronger, my love is stronger than your fear. Don't be afraid, my love is stronger, and I have promise to be always near. Don't be afraid, my love is stronger, my love is stronger than your fear. Don't be afraid, my love is stronger, and I have promised to be always near. Don't be afraid, my love is stronger, my love is stronger than your fear. Stronger, and I have promised to be always near. Please pray with me once again. Creator God, you have promised to be with us every day, especially in difficult days, especially in times like this. Give us, we pray, clarity in our minds, strength in our work and discernment, rest as we sleep, and peace in our spirits. Be with those who need help more than we do ourselves, and help us to see what we can offer from your love. Be with us, guide us, shepherd us, that we may be faithful to your ways of justice and peace. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I would just like to offer a blessing as you go from this worship time. As you go from here, take heart and good courage, and go with strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. And as you go, may the grace of Christ attend you, the love of God surround you, and the Holy Spirit keep you, now and forevermore. Amen.
walk with